the light of the world?
Amen.
No, he didn't say that we're supposed to be the judges of the world, right?
Right.
He said to be the light of the world. He didn't say be the judges or those who convict or those who condemn. He said be the light of the world. We're going to talk about that a little bit today. When we met last week, we left off in a story in the book of Mark. And that's where I'm going to start up today. We've been in this series talking about the woman at the well in Samaria that Jesus had gone out to meet, right? Everybody knows this. If you don't, you do now. And so we've been going through this series about this woman at the well. And then last week, we actually ended our message up with this scripture in Mark chapter 5. So if you got anybody, who's got a Bible with them?
I do.
All right, there we go. Good deal. We're going to talk about those today, too.
Oh, Lord.
Bibles?
Oh, yeah.
I got to get one with pictures.
Can you believe that? They're going to talk about Bible in church? Mark chapter 5, and we're not going to go through this whole story, but what we're talking about there is this man that met Jesus and he was actually possessed by a legion of demons.
My book.
All right? And so Jesus actually sent the spirits out of this man. And he actually sent him into this herd, about 2,000 pigs that ran into the sea and drowned. Okay? Well, the people of the land started begging Jesus to leave. Leave him alone. They didn't like the fact that he was coming and doing what he was doing in their own land. He didn't like that he was coming to affect the way their lifestyle, their way of living. And so they started asking him to leave, to go away. When they came to Jesus, they found this man who'd been delivered of the demons sitting at Jesus' feet. And that's what we're going to pick up right here in chapter 5, verse 18. As he, being Jesus, was getting into the boat, the man who had been demon-possessed kept begging him to be with him. But he would not let him. Instead, he told him, "Go back home to your own people and report to them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." This is where we ended up last week. And we're talking about how oftentimes we also, when we've been delivered from the old lifestyle, when we've come out of that muck and the mire that we were in when God came and got us, when we come out of that lifestyle, we've come out of addiction, we've come out of that slavery, we often think back on the things we used to do. Anybody felt that? We just want to die, man. Amen. Now that I've got Jesus, just take me home. Just take me to be with you.
Amen.
And that's where I see this man is like, let me just be with you. He'd given up. He'd been suffering for who knows how long. He's been suffering with this pain and this anguish and this rage and this violence. He'd been suffering, and now here's the Son of God who delivers him of these demons, and now all he wants to do is just go home. He just wants to go be with Jesus. But Jesus says, no, I've got something for you to do.
Amen.
Go back there and tell him what the Lord has done for you. Last week I mentioned a brother who has told me very similar things, and I didn't go into much detail because he tells his story a lot better than I could tell his story, so I've asked Doug to give you 5 minutes of his time today. Thank you.
How you guys doing tonight?
Good.
All right. I don't know, most of you might not know, but I was a heroin addict most of my life. Started shooting dope when I was like 13 years old and didn't stop till I was 40. And so it was pretty rough. And a lot of the times, man, I was really, once you was addicted and you get to a point where you just don't live. You want your life to end, and you don't do nothing. You stay in one place, do nothing but shoot dope, and get through tomorrow, and do the same thing over and over again. So, a lot of times I would just wish that God would take me. Why you keep me here? I'm not doing nothing. I'm no good. Take me. And many nights I'd pray for him for not to wake up the next day. I tried to overdose, but I couldn't, because I had too much tolerance for it. So I couldn't take my life, and I tried several times, but I just couldn't do it, you know. And when I finally decided to put drugs down for good, I was around 40 years old, and that's when God had found me and called me. And when I did come to God and give up everything of my life to Him, it was like a freight train running through my head. From the time I was a kid, from being abused all the way up until the time of the day it was, all the bad things, everything I've done, the nights I prayed to die, you know, it all come clear to me right then and there, because it's like a train in my head with these visions of me going out and helping people, that all I did, that's what He wants me to do now. And it all made sense to me. That's why God put me on the earth. And He didn't let me die. And, you know, I was very thankful for that. And I dove into it, and I just, you know, I love helping people any way I can. So, you know, I wrote down some scripture here. It's this short scripture. I know, like, we get new sins, and, you know, we feel guilty. Come in here and feel guilty about the sins. A lot. Yeah. But you know, in Psalms 32, 1 through 5 says, "Oh, what a joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sin is put out of sight. Yes, what joy for those whose record the law, the Lord has cleared of guilt, whose lives are lived in complete honesty. When I refuse to confess my sins, my body wastes away, and I groan all day long. The day and night your hand of discipline was heavy on me. My strength evaporated like water in the summer heat. Finally, I confessed all my sins to you and stopped trying to hide my guilt. I said to myself, I will confess my rebellion to the Lord, and you forgave me. All my guilt is gone." So, remember that, you know, when you're feeling guilty. Another thing that I'm guilty of, very, very guilty of, is when we give a testimony, you know, we give a testimony, we want to tell people what God has done for you. And you don't want to get wrapped up in what we've done back there, you know, because then you're glorifying the devil. Exactly. You know, you're not giving God the glory. You know, it starts to become about back then, you know, and I'm guilty of it, because I used to do it all a lot. My wife even told me about it a couple of times, but it had to see. I'm telling you. But it had to come to me, you know. It had to come to me in my time. So, when Psalms 32 says, "Why do you boast in evil, O mighty man? The goodness of God endures continually." That means we can talk about God all the time, man. That's great. Man, that's right. "Your tongue devices destruction like a sharp-edged razor, working deceitfully. You love evil more than good, lying rather than speaking righteousness. Your love in devouring words, you deceitful tongue. Good shall likewise destroy you forever." God, I'm sorry. And that's where, you know, if we don't watch what our tongue is saying,
right,
we can get wrapped up in what we used to do, and man, it can be like, before long, you're like right back there again, you know? So, you know, when you give a testimony, I have just recently really realized it, that, you know, it really sunk into me that you touch on what happened, you don't stay there, you go on and show them what the God has done in your life and how he has taken everything you've done and turned it around.
Right.
And now you're working for him.
Right.
So that's all I have to say. Right. And I just want to thank you guys.
You know, Doug was saying, you kept praying for God to take him home now, and God wouldn't do it. He wouldn't let him go home.
No hug for you.
And that's what I sing that right here. It says in verse 19, but he would not let him. Instead, he told him, go back home to your own people and report to them how much the Lord has done for you. And then what this series that we've been going through, what Doug is talking about there, I believe many of us have felt that way, and it's exactly what was going on with this man here. He was ready to go and be with Jesus, and Jesus said, well, wait a minute, I've got some work for you to do. The vision of Heaven's Highway is what we've been talking about with this series that we're in with the woman at the well, and we've been talking already how we're to be a body of repentant and redeemed sinners, right? Who's come out of that world, come out of the Samaria that we were in. And it says, and then penetrating the world we came from. See, that means we have a mission, just like Doug. God's given Doug a mission. He's also given you a mission. He's given us all a mission. We're on a mission for God now. We're no longer to live for ourselves, but live for the glory of God.
Amen.
So we've gotten to this point of penetrating the world that we've come from. And now we're gonna wrap that up. As we talk about this, how are we going to penetrate the world?
Getting out.
Jesus didn't tell this demon-possessed man to go to seminary school.
No.
He didn't tell him to go learn all the scriptures, all the law and the prophets, so that you can one day be full of knowledge and then go do some ministry. He didn't come to the demon-possessed man and tell him, well, this is what the law of God says. Now, if you go out and you get saved, then come back, I'm going to have some compassion on you, and I'll heal you.
Amen.
This isn't what he did. Matter of fact, he just told him, he didn't tell him to go into the world and preach the scriptures. He didn't say, go into the world and read them the law of God.
Amen.
That's ministry. He didn't say, go in the world and tell them what the prophets said was about to come. That was not the ministry that God gave this demon-possessed man. He said, go back to where you came from and tell them what I've done in your life, personally, your own life. Go tell them what you have seen with your own eyes. Go tell them about who you used to be, but then tell them about who you are now, not because you've done anything great, but because of what I have done for you. He said, this demon-possessed man, not to go and thump people over the head with the scriptures,
amen,
but to tell them what God did in their life. So we know how not to go penetrate the world, right?
Amen.
Why wouldn't Jesus do that? Why would Jesus tell them, just go tell them what I've done in your life? Why? I mean, if we've got the scriptures, right? We've got the Word of God right here. We study it. We should be studying it every day.
Amen.
Why wouldn't he tell us to go out there and tell them what my Word says? Tell them the scriptures. Tell them. Preach to them. Go over there and preach the Word of God. He didn't do that. Why not?
Because a good example is worth more.
It was a rhetorical question, Charlie. Go to 1 Corinthians with me.
Yeah, Charlie.
Amen. I love it. He keeps me on my toes.
We're going to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. This is Paul writing to the church in Corinth. He says, when I came to you, brothers, announcing the testimony of God to you, I did not come with brilliance of speech or wisdom. For I didn't think it was a good idea to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I came to you in weakness, in fear, and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not, listen, were not with persuasive words of wisdom, but with a powerful demonstration by the Spirit, so that your faith might not be based on men's wisdom, but on God's power. Paul determined that he was not going to go into the church of Corinth appearing as if he thought he was better than them. He made this determination he wasn't going to go to Corinth appearing as if he was holier than thou. No. That he had all this knowledge and wisdom now because he was a saved man. He said, if that's the case, you know, I'm not going to come to you and pretend to know more than you know. I'm going to come to you not to show you the wisdom that I've gained, but the power that God has done, what the Spirit has done in me. That powerful demonstration of the Spirit is what we see in the life of that demon-possessed man. It wasn't what the man knew. It wasn't the scriptures that he memorized. It wasn't what he learned in church on Sunday. It was none of those things. It was the power of the Spirit that delivered that man. And the only instruction Jesus gave to him was, go tell him what I did in your life. We need to, there's an important part of telling our testimony. And Doug got it right on the money. It's not about glorifying your past.
No.
Most of us don't have a past to want to get brought up, let alone be glorified.
Amen.
All right, that's not the purpose of giving a testimony. It's not to glorify the past. It's to glorify the God who delivered you from
Amen.
Your past.
Amen. That's, right.
That's what giving a testimony is about. And that's what God, that's what Jesus told this demon-possessed man to go do. We go on from there. Let's actually go over to verse 10, same chapter, verse 10. It says, now God has revealed these things to us by the Spirit. Understand first what Paul's saying. God has revealed, not your pastor, not your deacon, not your elder, not your neighbor. God has revealed these things to us through the Spirit. You see, you get with me right now?
Yep.
He's talking to those who are saved right now, okay? He's talking to those who have given their lives to Christ, and he says, God has revealed these things to us through the Spirit. And he goes on and says, for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For who among men knows the thoughts of a man except the spirit of that man that is in him?
Amen.
In the same way, nobody knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. What I want you to understand is, here, if somebody doesn't have the Spirit of God, they cannot know the thoughts of God.
Amen.
Okay? The only way we can understand what the Scriptures are saying and what God's talking to in the Scriptures to us through it is by having the Spirit in us.
Amen.
You cannot understand the things of the Spirit unless you have the Spirit in you.
Amen.
Right. And so what Paul's saying here is, who knows your thoughts? Look, you might be able to read somebody's face and sometimes think you can read their thoughts, but nobody knows your thoughts but you and God alone.
Amen.
Nobody knows God's thoughts except for the Spirit of God. So if you don't have the Spirit of God, you cannot know the thoughts of God. Therefore, those people in the world that we're going to penetrate that do not have the Spirit of God are not going to understand the things of God. So when you go out there with your Bible and you want to teach them what your Bible says, you're wasting your time.
Amen.
And you're wasting your breath. Because if you don't have the Spirit of God, you can't understand the things of the Spirit. You guys might not realize this, but I'm going to teach you something today. You see this here, this Bible?
Go, Bob.
This is for the Christian.
Amen.
This is not for the lost. This ain't for those who are still suffering in the world.
That's right.
This is for you.
Right.
You who have committed your life to Jesus Christ, and now you have an instruction manual.
Amen.
This is your instruction manual, not their instruction manual.
Amen.
Amen. He goes on from there. In verse 12. Now we have not received the spirit of the world, but the spirit who comes from God, so that we may understand what has been freely given to us by God. We also speak these things not in words taught by human wisdom, but in those taught by the Spirit, explaining, listen to this now, explaining spiritual things to spiritual people.
Amen.
Spiritual things to spiritual people, right?
Yeah.
Now listen again, but the unbeliever does not welcome what comes from God's Spirit because it is foolishness to him. He is not able to understand it since it is evaluated spiritually. This is coming from the Word of God. I'm telling you right now, you're wasting your time by preaching the Bible to the unsaved because they don't understand it. They're not able to understand it. You can condemn me, you can point your fingers at me, you can say, I can't believe the pastor said go preach without a Bible. But I'm telling you what the Bible says. I will be a biblical preacher the rest of my life. And the Bible says those without the Spirit cannot understand the things of the Spirit. They are unable to.
Amen.
My problem with ministries is the fact that I hear this all the time, and I talked about it a few weeks back. Somebody asked me one time what bothered me the most about ministry. And I say, the answer is the way it's done. The way it's done isn't true ministry oftentimes, man. You know, go door to door, knock on their door, and tell them about the Bible, read them the Bible. That's a whole day wasted.
I ain't answering the door.
See, no, you ain't answering the door with a shotgun. What I'm saying is, you know, to answer that question, if anybody's wondering what bothers me about ministry, it's the way things are done. I talked to many pastors, I've talked to many ministers in ministry, and the way things are done right now is ineffective. And they know it's ineffective, that's why they're asking me. How are you being so effective in the community? I'm not, God is. I'm just obeying what he said.
Amen.
Are you? Because he said that don't go out there preaching and throwing the Bible at people who aren't saved because they're not going to understand. The only thing they're going to see when you do that is that judgmental, condemning Christian that I can't stand.
Yep, that's right.
Representing a God that hates me and not loves me.
That's right.
That's some good stuff, Rob.
In 2 Corinthians,
come on.
Chapter 3. Second Corinthians chapter 3, beginning in verse 14. That doesn't sound right. I'm in 1 Corinthians. Uh-huh. Hey, give me a minute to catch up with you.
What?
2 Corinthians chapter 3, beginning in verse 14. It says, but their minds were closed, for to this day, at the reading of the old covenant, the same veil remains. It is not lifted, and this is extremely important, it is not lifted because it is only a set aside in Christ. What do you say? I'm saying that when the scriptures are read, there's a veil over our eyes until we've given our life to Christ. And only in Christ is that veil removed.
Yes.
Only when you gave your life to the Lord was the veil removed from your eyes that you could have a spiritual understanding of spiritual things. It goes on saying, even to this day, whatever Moses has read, a veil lies over their hearts. But whenever a person turns to the Lord, the veil is removed.
Amen.
Man, that's, you don't even have to preach on that. It says it all itself.
Amen.
Right. Only when someone turns to the Lord is the veil removed. So what good does it do if you're trying to shine a light in a dark world that's hurting and broken and just shattered and feels hated and judged and condemned by the church, and you're trying to shine a light and they got this veil over their eyes and you're shoving them back with a Bible in their face?
Right.
Yep. The only thing that's going to remove that veil is Jesus Christ. And that's why Jesus knew exactly what he said when he said, go tell them what I've done for you.
Amen.
You were possessed by demons. You were just full of anger and rage. You hated people. You were violent. You were self-destructive. They knew who you were, so now we'll tell them what I've done for you.
Amen.
That's all you have to do. Let God do the work. You just do, you be the obedient soldier of Christ when he calls you and sends you back out to Samaria or out to the clubhouses or out to the bars or out to the streets or out to your own house. Because some of you need to be bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ into your own house.
Amen.
Let's be real.
Amen.
That's right.
Man, Doug, did you steal my water?
No.
I'm about to start preaching here in a minute. So our vision is to penetrate the world we came from. Anybody know what the next part of that vision is? Because I've been saying it week after week. Anybody listening out there? I'm going to waste my own breath. Anybody remember what this vision is? To be a body of repentant and redeemed sinners. Penetrating the world we came from. No, not with the scrolls. Not with the scripture. Not even with the Bible. As crazy as that might sound in church, the vision is not even to penetrate the world you came from with the Bible and Jesus Christ. It's with the love and the compassion of Jesus Christ. You guys, this is the only way. This is the only way God's getting glory is when we're real.
Yes. Amen.
I say here just a few minutes ago and told you when I went to a Bible study, I had some confessions, man, and they were eating me alive. And it wasn't until I brought that truth out of my heart that I brought the true this disease that was in my heart, I brought it out into the light that there was healing.
Yeah.
And I want to go show the world what God's done in my life, but I'm only this at home.
Amen.
That's for me. It ain't for them. That's for me to learn. And look, to be honest with you, most ministers out there trying to preach this to the world, get them to do it, and they ain't doing it themselves.
Okay.
There's a problem with that. If the minister ain't living this, you know that you ain't supposed to be preaching that.
That's right. That's right.
So it's to penetrate the world we came from with the love and the compassion of Jesus Christ. And this is the way we're at now, the step we're on. So what's that going to look like? What's it going to look like when we actually fulfill the vision that God has given us as a family, as a body right here? Everybody heard that acronym TMI? Too much information.
Yeah.
Anybody ever been having a conversation? You walk away from the conversation thinking, man, I really didn't need to know that. Right? For me, it usually has something to do with some type of body fluid. I don't want it. You know, I don't need to hear how much pus you poked out of your pimple.
Hey. What are you doing?
How are you doing?
I don't want to hear about how much toe fungus you can produce. I don't need to know the color and the consistency of your baby's last poop. Yeah, and the phlegm, the mucus. Okay, you get where I'm going, right? Sometimes, man, you just don't need to hear it, right? Sometimes it's just considered too much information. There's a story in the Bible that can be classified as TMI. It's a story about a woman who had a problem. And this problem was more than just a little bit embarrassing.
Oh, I love those games.
It's actually, if you go back to Mark chapter 5, where we talk about the demon-possessed man in your Bibles, over here, pages turning, Mark chapter 5, we were just at. We finished the story about this demon-possessed man up in verse 20. I'm going to take you over to verse 24.
Amen.
You know, that's TMI, it's awkward, right? We're just talking about the want me to say it again? it can be awkward, right? Embarrassing, makes you want to cringe. In Mark chapter 5, verse 24, listen to this. So Jesus went with them, and a large crowd was following and pressing against them. A woman suffering from bleeding for 12 years had endured much under many doctors. She had spent everything she had and was not helped at all. On the contrary, she became worse. Now, what I want you guys to do is, I want to bring you to an understanding of just how bad this woman really had it. For 12 consecutive years, she had bleeding nonstop. Menstrual bleeding nonstop for 12 years consecutive. Every day, nonstop. Now, I'm going to tell you, this issue of blood would have rendered her unclean according to the Old Testament law. She'd have been considered unclean. As a matter of fact, everything she sat on or laid down on would also be considered unclean. Listen to this. Any man who touched anything she sat on, he would be considered unclean and would have to wash his clothes and bathe and offer temple sacrifices because he touched something this woman sat down and it was that bad. And look, this went on for 12 years straight.
She didn't have any friends, did she?
You know, no pious Jew would even come near for fear of ritual condemnation or ritual contamination. No Pharisee, no scribe, no pious Jew was going to come anywhere within close proximity of her because of the fact that they feared that by their religious standards, they themselves were going to be contaminated. Can you imagine how this woman felt?
That's right.
I heard a comment out there saying she had no friends, did she? Right. I couldn't believe she didn't. Because she wasn't even allowed in the same area as them.
Right.
Or they'd have been considered condemned. Not only did she not have any friends, but she would have been, she should have been a lock-in. She had no business being out public where there was people at. Imagine how this woman felt for 12 years struggling with this. Doctors were unable to help her, and her condition continued to get worse. Now, I don't know for certain, but I'm pretty positive back then tampons hadn't been invented yet. So this brings another subject up. She had to wrap herself in strips of linen and then continuously change them out as they became soaked through. So she couldn't really leave her house for expansions of time at all. She had to continually change these clothes and stuff out. So not only did she have any friends, she had no life at all. And she was probably condemned by the entire place she lived in. I mean, for 12 years, look, this was a small area, you guys. All right, this is one of those small towns like we have in rural America today that everybody knows everybody and everybody's in everybody's business.
Yeah.
There's no way that everybody in the town didn't know this woman had this problem going on. So not only did she have any friends, but anytime she walked out of her house, she'd have been judged. Anytime she walked out of her house, she'd have been mocked and laughed at. She'd have been persecuted. She'd have been drugged down in the muck and the mire as if it wasn't already bad enough.
That's right.
Like I said, I want you to understand how bad this woman really had it. Because as if her physical condition wasn't bad enough, you also need to add to it that the religious and social stigma that was attached to her. Like I said, in that small village, everybody knew everybody's business. So there's a social stigma that she's attached to her. She's also got the religious stigma attached to her. She's not supposed to be around people. She's supposed to be locked up, you know what I mean? Kind of like that man that we read was demon-possessed. Couldn't be out in public because he had all that anger and rage and violence. it was just like today, you know, the people want to lock them up in prison or put them in a psych ward. When really what they need is to see a truth in Jesus Christ. So she was a continual object of gossip, ridicule, mockery, shame. The locals were probably convinced that she was condemned by God. You know what? Maybe she even believed it, because 12 years with no relief, what other hope do you have left?
Amen.
12 years with no relief, she probably believed this herself, that she was cursed by God.
Right.
So this woman's just, probably just like Doug said, man, I want to die. Just let me die. Take me home. Her money was all gone. Her disease was gaining on her. But listen to me. Desperate people do desperate things.
Amen.
Desperate people do desperate things.
Amen.
In verse 27, it says, having heard about Jesus, she came behind him in the crowd and touched his robe.
Amen.
For she said, if I could just touch his robes, I'll be made well. Instantly, her flow of blood ceased, and she sensed in her body that she was cured of her affliction.
Amen.
So at this point, what we see is Jesus is reaching like rock star status, right? Because she'd heard about this Jesus guy that was coming through town. He was the stuff back then, you know what I mean? These people are just hearing about him. He's curing people and he's healing people. And so she hears about this. And so this woman who is not supposed to have anything to do with anybody, not be around anybody, should be shut up in her quarters, and especially not even be in close proximity to a rabbi.
Amen.
Reaches out to touch his robe. You can add her now to the list of people who socially should have never even approached Jesus.
That's right.
Well, when I say to the list, listen, because there's a list of people who socially in the Bible should never even approach Jesus. People like lepers. People like demon-possessed men who were angry and violent. People like tax collectors. People like sinners. And now this woman who culturally shouldn't even be able to approach Jesus by the religious status, right? So you added her to the list now. And she was actually even worse than them, because according to the rules, again, no woman should approach a rabbi in public, especially a woman of her condition. So she was probably the worst on this list that we've added her to. She shouldn't even come near Jesus. And making contact with him would have been forbidden. In fact, making contact with Jesus would not only have been forbidden, but that would have rendered Jesus unclean. The Son of God, by this woman's actions, could have rendered the Son of Man, the Son of God, unclean. She heard about Jesus. And what I believe is that she saw, because of the stories she's heard, like this demon-possessed man, when Jesus told him, go back and tell him what I've done for you. Like we just heard about Doug, I was healed of a 20-year heroin addiction or a 30-year heroin addiction. Because of the testimonies that she's heard of what Jesus was doing, she found Jesus to be her last and only remaining hope. You ever feel that way?
Yep.
Like there ain't no hope left. To be honest with you, that's why most of us even turn to the Lord. Because it was the last and only remaining hope there was. And if this didn't work, we quit.
Yep. That's right.
I believe this woman was there. I'm gonna go touch the hem of his robe, and if it doesn't work, I quit. Listen, you guys, I mean, this hits me in my heart because I can just picture this woman heart racing. Because you gotta realize what could have happened to her had she got caught, had she been recognized and noticed amongst this big crowd of people pushing through to reach this rabbi, this what we know now as the Messiah, but this rabbi that was going around teaching unheard of things about God, right? Imagine she knows the consequences if she gets caught. So I can just picture her heart just pounding in her chest, hiding her face, bowing her head, just in hopes that she doesn't get recognized, reaching out for that very last hope, the only hope left. You want a perfect picture of faith? There it is.
Amen.
Yep.
Amen.
That's the perfect picture of a real faith.
Yes.
To not really give a darn about what the religions say or what the Pharisees say or what anybody says except for what God says. Because yeah. Jesus said, come to me, all of you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. The scribes, the Pharisees, they would have kept her away. You can't come around the Lord Jesus. You're an unclean woman. You're condemned. Go back to your room.
Amen. Right.
But she didn't listen to that. She heard the cry of Jesus, come to me, all of you. So here this woman, like I said, her heart's just thumping. She's got her head down. She can't even look at the crowd. She's just reaching through the crowds of people that have condemned her. Just reaching through the crowds of people that have judged her. Reaching through the crowds of people who have cast her aside and considered her now an outcast and somebody who's unworthy and has no value in life and has no good intentions in them and there's nothing good about her. Through this big crowd of people that for 12 years have cast her aside and fed her to the dogs, she's now reaching through these people with her eyes closed, hiding her face for the last hope out there. And all of a sudden she stops.
Yep, right now.
Yes.
12 years. And it stops immediately, the scriptures say.
Amen.
I ain't read no faith like that before. Matter of fact, that's such a great story right there. That could be the end of the story, man.
Amen.
You know, the story can stop right there. This woman had such great faith that she went against the crowds. She went against the crowds of sheep that are being led off the cliff.
Yeah.
To reach the one true Savior. And she was healed immediately, and the story could stop right there, but it doesn't.
Nope.
It doesn't stop there. In verse 30, it says, at once Jesus realized in himself that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and said, who touched my robes? His disciples said to him, you see the crowd pressing against you, and you say, who touched me? So he was looking around to see who had done this. What was everybody's reaction to this? You know, it doesn't even say what the reaction of the crowds were. They're now aside. It doesn't even matter what the crowds had to say. It doesn't matter anymore what the multitudes had to say. But those who judged and condemned and convicted and cast aside, you know what? It wasn't even worthy. What they had to say, their reaction wasn't even worthy to record in the scriptures. In fact, the reactions we see, what was Jesus' reaction? First of all, I find it pretty cool that this woman was healed without even Jesus making a conscious effort. Because it says that he felt the power go out from him. Jesus didn't turn around and say, woman, be healed. It was her faith that made her well.
Yes. Amen.
It was an unconscious effort on Jesus' part. And so Jesus says, who touched my robes? This was Jesus' reaction. And what were the disciples' reactions?
A lot of people.
They were actually pretty sarcastic. they had a pretty sarcastic attitude towards the Lord. Ooh. Right? I mean, like, come on, man. Seriously? You see there's crowds all over the place. You really want to know who touched you? Are you crazy? You know, you got to love the disciples for believing that Jesus needed a reality check, right? So what was Jesus' response? We know his reaction was, who touched me? What was Jesus' response to this public defilement? Rebuked her?
No, he healed her.
Public chastised?
No.
Maybe, yeah, give her some lashes. Maybe just humiliate her a little further, right? Woman, you unclean woman, what are you doing around this holy rabbi? Go back to Samaria, right? Go back to where you came from. You ain't got no business being here. You've been bleeding for 12 years. You shouldn't even come out of your cage. In verse 33, it says, then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came with fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. Daughter, he said to her, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be free from your affliction. You know, you even see right there in the scripture that this woman was scared to death of what was going to happen when she was caught. What was going to happen when she stepped out of what all this religious stuff was telling her she had to do. All this tradition, right? When she stepped out of that, she was scared to death. But it was faith. And by faith, she stepped out and she squeezed past. Now listen, I mean, I want you to understand the reality of this. Not only when she was going through the crowds to reach the Lord, would she have been condemned and convicted because she was touching Jesus, but you understand that everybody who knew they were touched by her was also going to be considered unclean.
Right.
They would have just had a big lashing against her. I mean, they would have convicted and condemned and killed her. Because how many people do you think she touched and made unclean on her way to the Savior?
Amen.
By their religious statuses, their religious ways, their tactics and everything. By everything that the traditions teach, just about everybody there would have become defiled and it would have been all her fault by not following the rules of religion. And it says right here in the scripture that she came when Jesus said, who touched my robes? You notice she didn't jump up and say, it was me! I got the faith! I had the faith to be healed! Like we do in church today.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Amen.
He said, who touched my robe? And she knew, oh man, I've been exposed.
Busted,
yeah. I've been exposed. But she knew that it stopped.
Yep.
She knew the power came. She knew the healing had come. She knew she was delivered. And so there was no hiding anymore. There was no hiding. As a matter of fact, the scripture says she came to the feet. She fell at his feet, trembling and in fear, knowing that, you know what, it was all worth it. I know now that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. He's the Savior. He's healed me. And it's all been worth it. And I'm going to fall at his feet and just confess what I just did.
Amen.
I'm going to admit everything. It says she told him everything.
Yep.
And she fell at his feet and said everything. She laid it all down at his feet, expecting to be judged and condemned. Expecting to be, if not killed, at least locked up the rest of her life. But you know what? I believe she probably expected the least was that compassion that Jesus gave her. I don't think she expected that. Especially with all the religious fools around there.
Yeah.
I don't think she expected that compassion. I love this. He says, I'm going to go back there. I'm going to read this to you again. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came with fear and trembling. I want you to get this picture in your head. Fell down before him and told him the whole truth. And listen to Jesus' response. Daughter. What kind of compassion, man? Do you understand this is the only time that we have recorded in all the gospel that Jesus called somebody daughter? And it was a woman that was supposed to be condemned and locked up.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
And Jesus had such compassion on this broken woman, hurt woman, that he turned around and rather chastising and condemning and saying, you know the rules. You know the laws. You know you got no right touching me. You know I'm holy and you're unclean. Instead, turned and said, daughter, your faith has made you well. And did you hear me on this last part? Go in peace and be free from that affliction you thought was going to kill you. Be free. It's over. It's finished. I've taken. Jesus should have been made unclean by her touching him. But in fact, because she reached out in faith, regardless of what all this religious around her was saying, she reached out in faith, rather than Jesus being made unclean, she became clean. And it was through faith in Christ. Jesus... Jesus didn't roll up a scroll and thump her in the head with it when she touched him. He didn't tell that demon-possessed man to go get saved so that you can come back and I can heal you.
Amen.
He didn't preach about adultery to that adulteress the Pharisees brought before him. He didn't tell her, he didn't read from the law about thou shalt not commit adultery when she was brought before him. Let's look at that for a minute. All these times that we hear about somebody being healed and delivered by Jesus Christ, it was never through the scroll. It was never through the scripture. It was through the power of the Holy Spirit. It was through love. It was through compassion. It was through mercy. Matter of fact, we've been talking about this woman at the well in Samaria, right? Did you remember when we were reading through that, that when that woman came to the well, even when he said, go get your husband, and she said, I don't have a husband, he said, I know, you've been married 5 times and you're not living with the man, or you're not married to the man you're living with now. He didn't break out that back pocket Bible and start. Well, the word of God says you're a sinner and you're going to hell unless you change your ways. He didn't pull out the law and the prophet and start quoting scripture to her. Matter of fact, that woman ran back to Sychar because of the power she saw in Christ, because of the love and the mercy and the compassion that she saw in Christ. She ran back to tell the man in her town, you got to see this man. You got to come see this man who told me everything I've ever done and loved me anyway and had compassion and mercy on me. Exactly. And that's exactly what I want to get you guys to. This is how we're going to penetrate the world we came from. Not by going out and thumping on the scripture. You don't get me wrong. You need to know the scripture. You're a saved child of God. This is your instruction manual. You need to know how you're supposed to be living, how you're supposed to be being transformed. This is your Bible, not their Bible out in the world. They need that love and compassion and mercy. Jesus rejected the stigma of social and religious uncleanness. You guys, you with me on that? Jesus actually rejected that stigma of social uncleanness, of religion. In Samaria, when he entered Samaria, that town we talked about, or that land we talked about several weeks ago, that most churches will tell you don't go. You shouldn't be going to those places. Jesus rejected that stigma. And the Samaritan woman, the immoral Samaritan woman, he rejected that stigma. And this woman that we're talking about today, who was considered unclean and banished from society, Jesus rejected that stigma. Jesus went to all places and ministered to all people, and he did it with compassion and love and mercy. Yeah. Not with condemnation, judgment, and scriptures. Jesus went into all places, ministered to all people, and he did it regardless of their social status. That had no bearing on who he was talking to. Had no bearing on the places he would go. And you know what? He's commanding you to do the exact same thing. Because he told the disciples, go and make disciples of all nations, teaching them to obey what I have given to you. Make sure. Yeah. There's a scripture where it talks about Jesus looked out at this swarms of people, this multitude of people. They were broken. They were hurt. They were a lot like the people that you see in Toledo today. Broken, hurt, addicted, angry, swallowed up, confused. And sad as it is, the church stays inside the church. Because they think that's icky. They think that there's an unclean land under there, unclean people. We've got to stay away from that or we're going to get contaminated too. The scripture says that Jesus looked out and saw the multitudes. And you know what the scripture says? Jesus, or Charlie, what does it say? You just said it. The scripture actually says Jesus saw the multitudes and had compassion on them.
Right.
Because they were like sheep without a shepherd. Think in your head for a minute about the community you live in. No, wait. First think about the home you live in. Come Pentecost, when they received the power of the Spirit, they were told to preach in Jerusalem, to minister and make disciples in Jerusalem. They're going to, right? In Jerusalem, and then Samaria, and then to the ends of the world. It had to start where they were at. It has to start in your life, in your home. And only then can you take it into Samaria. If you're not applying it in your home, don't think you're going to apply it out in Samaria. But I want you to think about your home. I want you to think about the community you live in. I want you to think about the places all around Toledo right now. Isn't that the same people Jesus looked out and saw multitudes and had compassion on?
Yep.
Broken, lost, hurt, addicted, sinners.
That's right.
Just like they're then, they're here now.
Amen.
Just like you were.
Amen.
Just like I was. They are. And by taking your Bible in there to read it to them, you're wasting your time, your breath, and you're wasting their time.
That's right.
Why? Where does it say that? Where's your exception at?
Well, because it goes along with if I'm going to tell somebody what God has done for me and shown me.
I'm going to tell you right now, if you would come to me in my old days and told me that Jesus loved me so, or God loved me so much that he sent his only son, so that whoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life, and you didn't show me Jesus in your own heart, I'll tell you, get that out of my house.
That's what I'm saying.
I'm just being true, though.
If I'm showing that women, I also want to share that with them?
No, I'm not. Okay, yeah. Let's not say you're never supposed to read anything from that. What I'm saying is when you're going out to these Samaritans, understand that they're not looking for you to sit down and do a Bible study. That's what I know what you're saying. Yeah, but you can't. Yeah, absolutely. Because here's the deal. What you're going to find out. No, I agree with you. But what you're going to find out is this. When they start seeing the light in your life, when they start seeing a changed life, they're going to come and ask you what happened. They're going to come and ask you, how did that happen? How did you change your life? How did you become this from that?
Yep.
You see what I'm saying? And that opens the door. Now they're questioning. Now the Spirit's at work.
Now you can share that.
Absolutely. Now the Spirit's at work. What I'm talking about is what I'm talking about is people that walk in there with a Bible in arm going into the bars thinking they're going to do ministry. They're going to get booted right back out of there. Okay? That's all I'm saying. Yeah, no, they're you know, even with John 3:16, a great scripture, but there's no scripture that's not great. But those are really for the Christian. All right? And that's a good scripture that God will use to work on somebody's heart, bringing them to them. But what's going, the only thing that's going to penetrate that world is your love and your compassion. That's it. Relationship, absolutely. And this is what we need to get to. And here's the thing. I don't even think I read a scripture that I was supposed to read. Look at you guys, got me on track and stuff.
Yeah, we did it. It was all us.
That's right. This is a scripture. Listen, I'm just going to read it to you. It's out of 2 Corinthians chapter 1. It says that he comforts us in all our affliction so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction through the comfort we ourselves received from God. You want to know what I get from that? You all were once lost.
Yep.
You all were once unsaved sinners.
Amen.
But somehow or another, God showed you mercy.
That's right.
He showed you love. He showed you compassion.
Amen.
And now with the same love that he's given you, you're now able to give to others that are in any type of sin. Let me ask you, who is going to be the best person to have compassion on a cancer patient?
Somebody
who God's delivered from cancer. Or, you know what? Maybe God's still working on in that situation, but somebody who understands where they're at. Listen, don't go to a cancer patient and tell them you understand what they're going through if you've never been had cancer.
That's right.
Okay? Don't do it. Don't go into prison ministry telling those prisoners that you understand what they're going through if you've never been locked up in prison.
That's right. Amen.
Because you're deceiving them. You're lying to them.
Yep.
You have no idea what it's like to be locked up in prison.
Amen.
Don't go to a heroin addict and tell them you don't understand the struggles if you've never struggled with it.
Amen. That's right.
There's no better person to have compassion on somebody who's caught up in some type of something than someone who's already been there.
That's right.
All right?
Amen.
I was talking to Doug about this the other day, and Charlie, we were talking about prison ministry, because that's one of the outreaches that are going to be coming up. I've never served time in prison. Way too much time in jail.
Yeah.
Way too much time in jail, but I've never had to live life in prison. Praise God, I never have.
Praise God.
But you know what? I also could never go in there and tell them prisoners that I understand what they're going through, that I know how they feel, because I've got no people. I'm not the right guy to have that much compassion on someone who's in prison because I can't understand what they're going through. Not to say that I can't minister to somebody, that I can't love and have compassion on them. I'm just telling you that I can't understand the things they're going through because I ain't never been there.
Amen.
In a way, I mean, you know, it was like you're locked up.
It's different.
There's a big difference from what I hear between prison and jail.
Believe me.
Yeah.
I didn't have to have soap on a rope in jail. TMI. Sorry, but I love you, man. All right, let's get back to the message on before we get in trouble. So who better to show compassion? What we're reading here in 2 Corinthians. That's why we're having, a part of what we're doing at this meeting next Saturday, the members meeting, we'll start talking about some of these possibilities of outreach that we're getting into. You know, everybody here's been through something. Everybody here struggled with something. There's somewhere in your heart and your compassion and your love is needed right now. What we have to do is drop that religious stigma. Study the word amongst each other and at home so we can go live it out in the world and be the light rather than trying to blind somebody with something they have no way to understand, no ability to understand. And so when we have this meeting Saturday, there's some things we want to talk about, what outreaches are coming up, because everybody here has gone through something, every single person. You know, I had a discussion with, and I hope you don't mind me pointing you guys out, but I had a discussion the other day with Charlie and his wife Cindy, and they have an experience that I don't have. They have been somewhere that I've never been. Like I just said, I've never been locked in prison. I hope you don't mind me pointing you out, if so, then shoot me later. But Charlie can have compassion on those men in prison because he knows what that lifestyle is like. Amen. He knows what they're going through. Right. And you know what? Cindy can also have compassion on her families because while he was locked up, she was in prison at home.
Amen.
We have no idea. Thank God my wife has no idea what it's like to have a husband locked up in prison. What it's like to live life without your husband because he's locked up. But we have people here who know. And that's the person who's going to have compassion. When these men are in the prison, ministering to the prisoners, somebody needs to be showing love and compassion to their families. And we've been blessed by God to have that wisdom and that love and compassion right here in this body. You know, we talked about strip clubs before. I'm going to tell you that we're going to have a group of, I'll do it one more time. We're going to have a group of women.
All right.
That can understand that lifestyle, because I'll be honest with you, man. Most of the strippers that I knew back in the day did not want to be doing that for a living.
That's right.
And this is truth. You know, people mock and make fun of, or people make fun of, I guess they're working their way through college. Well, there really is some women that are trying to work their way through college because they're trying to provide a life for their children. Right. And you know what? They get locked up. They get caught up in things that are going on inside there. Right. It takes a lot of gall to get out there and take your clothes off on a stage. Yeah. So a lot of them will do a little bump cocaine. They'll do a little shot of heroin. They'll shoot some whiskey down just to get up that courage and the nerve to get out there. And that becomes a devil. It becomes an addiction, and they become enslaved to it. There's women in here right now who understand and know that personally, and they're going to go in and show love and compassion to somebody who all the church has condemned and judged because of their lifestyle. That's ministry.
Yeah.
In John chapter 4, we're going to end this series right now. In John chapter 4, we're back at the woman at the well. In verse 39, it says, "Now many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of what the woman said when she testified." You guys look blank, man. You get amen?
Yeah.
Am I loud enough? Listen, many Samaritans from the town believed in him because of what the woman said when she testified.
Amen.
Not when she preached, not when she thumped with scripture, not when she read from the Bible, when she testified.
That's right.
About Amen. Jesus and what he just did in her life.
Amen.
He told me everything I ever did. Therefore, when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him, therefore, when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of what he said. And they told the woman, "We no longer believe because of what you said, for we have heard for ourselves and know that this really is the Savior of the world."
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. We got a plan that God has put together.
Yes.
And this is it. Listen, we have probably the most ridiculous church in Toledo. Praise God.
Amen.
People have heard me say this time and again, we have a church of misfits, and I love it.
That's right.
I love it.
That's right.
Because all over this church right now, I see lives transformed by the power of God.
Yeah. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
That's true gospel.
Right.
I don't care how much scripture you guys can memorize. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm never going to be proud of you because you memorized the whole Bible.
Amen.
But if I see a little transformation, that's going to bring me more joy than you remember in the entire New Testament.
Amen.
We have transformed lives. Do you understand that you're surrounded right now by true miracles?
Amen.
Right here in this church, you are surrounded by miracles right now. And God has put a plan in place. We're going to have this meeting. We're going to start going forward. There's going to be some outreaches. And this is what you guys are going to do, because I said it last week. You know, Jesus talked about the 99 sheep on the hill. You leave the 99 to go after the one that's lost. But man, the things that can happen when the 99 go out looking too.
Yeah. Amen.
You're the 99 that's going to go out looking.
Amen. That's right.
The world that you're still around, that your family, man, your own home. Jerusalem, right?
Yep.
And then in the Samaria, the places God allows you to continue going to, you're now going for a purpose and a reason. I've had Christians tell me ever since I got in the ministry, "You got no business going to the bars." Listen, I got more business now going to the bars than I've ever had. There's going to be now. Don't misunderstand me, because if you're new in your walk, I'm not telling you that you need to go out into the world right now. You don't. You're the one that we're loving on. Okay, you're the one that we're bringing in and putting arms and surrounding you with love and compassion right now, because we've all been there. And if you're one of the ones that's new in your walk right now, don't think that you're alone. Let me tell you that every single person was at one time new in their walk in here, okay? There's going to be a discipleship process. That's why we have Bible studies. That's why we have small groups. That's why we have Celebrate Recovery, because there's going to be ministry. There's going to be discipleship. But there's going to come a point in time when God says, "Go and make disciples." All right? And this is how we're going to do it.
Amen.
Showing love and compassion. Because just as we've read today, we've learned there's a veil over their eyes.
Yes.
They can't understand spiritual things. But when you show them a changed life, and you love on them, regardless of their status, their social status, or their religious status, you love on them anyway, they're going to start wondering, what happened to that dude? Can I point you out for a minute? How many times you hear me come into the clubhouse and start preaching scriptures, bro?
Amen.
Shorty's a long-standing member of the club that I was once in, and when I go back in there, I went in there and read a scripture one time, and it was because they asked me to. It was for a funeral service.
Yeah, that's so.
But this is the thing, and I'm sorry if I hope I didn't offend you by pointing you out, but I'm going to tell you that I've got a brotherhood in that clubhouse that I love with all my heart, and that never went away when I came to the Lord. Matter of fact, that grew even more when I came to the Lord.
That's right.
And so now I'm able to go back in there with love and compassion. And most of the time, I only have a Bible on me.
Nope.
My Bible's at home where I just got done reading it before I left to go out there. But my only responsibility while in there is shining a light, walking in it myself, and showing love and compassion.
Amen.
And in this way, I can't tell you how many people I've called or have called me and said, "Dude, what's really going on with you?"
Amen.
Now, listen to me. I screwed up too.
Amen. Mm-hmm. We all do.
There's reason why Jesus said, "Send them out two by two."
Amen.
There's a reason. Seriously, man, you need to have that accountability. You really need to go through some discipleship, go through some training, and be covered by the hedge of protection that the church offers you.
Right.
Which means going out the way that we train you up to go.
Yep.
All right? This is important. That covering is very important, because I messed up.
Yeah.
I'm going out there thinking I was going to go into ministry, went in by myself, and let the devil minister to me.
Amen. Exactly.
And not even say, hey, you know what, I won't even blame it on the devil. I'm under there and do what I wanted to do.
Yes, that's right.
What the old flesh, what the old man wanted to do.
Yes.
Talk about ruining a testimony. It took me a long time to rebuild that testimony for some of those brothers.
Yeah.
So that has to be very... Who said I remember? Shh. I'm just kidding with you. You guys ready to get out of here?
No.
All right, let's go to the next scripture.
All right.
You guys with me? Man, this is extremely important. What we see here with when she went back to Sychar and said, you know, you've got to come meet this man. He told me everything I've ever done. It says that they believed because of her testimony, and so they became Christ.